The prelude playing on the stage speakers begins to be overtaken by the buzz of chatter as Jazmine peers out into the multiplying crowd. A narrow, empty runway stretches into the audience under white-hot lights as countless photographers line the edges of the catwalk, causing the pit in her stomach to sink further.
I think I might be sick,
she whispers, closing the curtain in futile hope that the leering eyes waiting for her would disappear from her mind.
I know how you feel,
Alexa confesses, cradling her own chin in one hand and sinking into deep concentration.
Upman's increased security and Sunny Stickers haven't anything to report. We know the killer is out there somewhere, hiding, waiting for this moment. If only I didn't have to be part of this show, I could use all three of my private eyes to cover our bases.
Jazmine snaps Alexa out of her rambling daze with a sardonic chuckle.
No, I mean the crowd. Being in front of Weston or even Duffy was one thing, but this? There's hundreds of people out there.
Jazmine says, skin going pale as she sinks to the floor.
I've been dreading this since day one.
Alexa can't help but crack a smile, her own wariness softening.
Of course. This could very well be the day you die, but heaven forbid you go out on stage.
Jazmine scoffs, rebuffing her lover's concern for the comfort of a cheap, cynical joke.
Actually, I think I'll take the whole being murdered thing now that I'm here. Please be more serious.
The taller woman begs, wrapping her arms around herself. Jazmine looks back up to see Alexa bite her lip as she holds back tears, and a wash of shame brings some color back to her skin. Her eyes wander beyond her lover to spy the ominous newspaper that predicts this very day to be her last, sticking haphazardly out of a purse, its date staring her in the face.
Yeah, you're right. Sorry.
Jazmine! For God's sake, get off the floor!
Theodore shouts, hurriedly making adjustments to Sunny's first dress.
The program begins in 5 minutes, and I can't have you traipsing around out there with wrinkles in my design. If we're walking to our doom, we should look our best, yes?
The tailor whips the downtrodden model with a spare piece of fabric, corralling her and her fellows into their proper place in line as he continues to make last-minute adjustments to their ensemble. Before anyone notices, the presenter of the runway event stands at the edge of the catwalk, microphone in hand.
Thank you all for coming today to the 5th annual San Francisco Fashion Week!
Blast!
Theodore curses as he spits out the needle he was holding in his mouth.
So much for punctuality. They started early, those bastards.
Standing tall, Theo flanks his four models and stiffens his spine, sharp-dressed man appearing behind him.
Well, we're as ready as we can be. Girls, don't forget, the Square Biz Killer is out there somewhere in the crowd. Today's our last chance. Don't let your guards down.
At this proclamation, the Fab Four regain their poise, summoning their own stands as if they were charging into battle. The beating of their hearts urges them forward like a drum, but as the tension compounds with each second, fills them instead with a sense of dread, becoming a ticking clock counting down to disaster. As the announcer continues his introduction of the event, he motions to the curtain behind him, where Maison's models await the hand of fate to strike.
And of course, we must begin with none other than the preeminent Maison and their new line, the Children of Destiny.
The lights go out, leaving the arena engulfed in darkness. After a moment of quiet, the faintest flickering of light follows Jazmine as the starlet wanders from the darkness of the sable veil into the returning spotlights. Limelight encircles her protectively, casting flourishes of rainbow light on the model's countenance. But as the glowing model approaches the end of the runway, she freezes, overtaken by a deep fear. Beyond the glimmering sea of paparazzi, the specter of death made itself known to her.
I can't.
She stammers, staring helplessly into the goading void, each flash of the camera a pernicious barb. Tragedy slips through the interstice of the strobing lights and strikes. Jazmine stands under the spotlight, completely shattered and destroyed, nearly half of her body missing in a perfect right angle from her torso to the very top of her golden hair. The glowing aura that surrounded the starlet has faded as what is left of her tumbles like a rag doll to the cold tile. And witnessing it all firsthand, Alexa Zivojinovic shudders mere steps away from what remains of her lover. There was no escaping the preordained. The light of the star that had captured so many hearts and minds was snuffed out, leaving the universe a dull and lonesome place. Alexa jolts from her restless slumber in a pool of sweat, plagued by a relentless nightmare growing in strength with each passing day. But tonight was the first night without Jazmine beside her when she awoke, accompanied only by the lonesome sound of flowing water, which she assumed was rain. She scrambles in disbelief, desperately searching for a sign of her lover, but she is far too weak to cry out Jasmine's name, and too unfocused for private eyes to be of any use. Her dreams were far too vivid to discern them from reality. Was this nightmare an echo of the past haunting her even in her dreams, or simply the culmination of her worst fears played out in fantasy? Thankfully, an angel's voice responds to answer an unspoken prayer from across the room.
It's the 28th now, technically. 2 a.m.
Jazmine wanders over from the ensuite bathroom, placing a cold, wet rag atop Alexa's brow. It was only a nightmare. Even the rain seems to have ceased. The flip clock on the nightstand turns over, calling Alexa's attention as if to affirm that she remained distant from that fateful future.
We have half a month left before the deadline. Don't worry, I'm still here.
My... Jazmine...
Alexa stammers, every syllable spoken through gasps of breath. Jazmine sits on the edge of their shared bed, staring off into the darkness, and Alexa feels the weight of her lover shift the springs of the mattress. The arm of the smaller woman reaches out to pull her in, snaking her fingers through the long, raven-colored hair that she rests onto her shoulder. Alexa exhales shakily as her stress begins to abate, either due to the cool, damp cloth or under the physical touch of her loved one. But her mind still mercilessly replays the nightmare.
Even in my dreams, you're like this. Are you truly not scared of dying?
Jazmine pauses from absent-mindedly playing with Alexa's hair to consider the question.
I guess it is weird, huh? Considering how much I was afraid of when we first met. I used to feel like I had to run from everything just to stay safe.
With her free hand, she touches the miniature crystal pyramid dangling from her neck, staring into it as the prism graces a moonbeam and invokes a faint rainbow glow.
But a lot's different now. Like now, I have you. With you, I feel safe for the first time in my life. More than that, I feel like I can take on anything. Fight anyone.
Jazmine clenches her fist as if promising to deliver it to fate itself.
Cheat death.
Alexa lifts her head, the towel falling from her brow as she reaches for her lover's hand and wraps her slender fingers around Jasmine's knuckles, assured of her strength of will.
That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
She chuckles.
And yet I can't help but believe it.
With her other hand still tangled in dark hair, Jazmine draws Alexa back in to rest her forehead on her lover's, and their breathing quietly sinks and fills the silence between them. Without another word, Alexa slowly leans in, and they share in a long, deep kiss. When Jazmine finally pulls away to look her partner in the eyes, she can see herself in their cerulean shimmer, like watching her reflection dance on the surface of the ocean as tears gather to disturb the image. She cups her partner's cheek, her thumb catching a stray drop from the sea of blue. A faint smile cracks through her lips, and she whispers,
"Get some rest, Alexa. In the morning, it's back to Maison, and back to the hunt for the Square Biz Killer."
Easy with that!
Upman gripes from the center of his office as a series of burly men haphazardly carry loads of furniture into his otherwise barren workspace.
That's imported Pennsylvania cherry wood. Damn thing costs more than any one of your lives,
he declares while instructing them where to place the lavish crimson cabinetry. The hefty furniture sounds with a thud as it is laid against the empty wall where the president's liquor cabinet once was. Now taking its place is an equally robust standing shelf of pre-aged burgundy lumber. Upman nods in content with his hands on his hip, gauging how apt the new fixture fits in among its fellow furnishings. He walks 3 paces from one end to the other, muttering to himself,
"Good. A little smaller than the last, but I'll not complain much. The color is a perfect match, at least."
With the scribble of his signature on a checkbook, Upman tears the piece of parchment and hands it to the nearest mover, who is still catching his breath from the workload.
"You'll find I've paid in full,"
He rubs the note with his thumb, revealing 4 crisp $20 bills underneath. And tipped handsomely. Put one in each of your pockets and tell your boss I was stingy. Now hurry up and make yourself scarce. Your job is done. The movers could hardly complain as they meandered through the doorway and out of the president's office, almost bumping into Weston Archer making his way through the threshold.
Careful there, string bean.
One of them mutters as the awkward photographer cautiously pushes a dolly of large unmarked crates stacked atop each other.
I brought what you asked for.
Slightly intimidated by the hulking brutes taking their leave, Weston speaks softly, almost inaudible to the company president.
The store owner's jaw almost hit the floor when I walked in with a blank check and your mile-long list. Luckily, it was all mostly in stock.
Anything you couldn't find? Upman asks, still enamored with his new liquor cabinet, blowing off some of the dust still sitting on its shelves. Weston answers as he unstacks each box from atop themselves, randomly opening one of them to remove one bottle of liquor from its place upon a bed of straw.
You'll have some trouble getting a hold of Russian vodka. No Kubanskaya for you, I'm afraid.
The elder connoisseur takes the bottle from Weston's hand and stares at a flask of Luxardo Amaretto, admiring its amber hue as the morning light washes in through the penthouse office's floor-to-ceiling windows.
Sorry to make you do this for me, Weston.
Upman sighs, placing the spirit precisely where he wanted it.
It's not like this is something Mina could do unless I asked her to break a couple laws.
Weston snickers, moving the box of alcohol up to the countertop as he assists in storing the bottles in their proper place.
She'd probably crumple like a leaf at the suggestion.
A rumbling chuckle creaks from the old man's throat, though he wouldn't allow this moment of levity to last.
A clear spirit on that side. That's a top-shelf gin, he instructs. I simply don't want to be wasting your time. To be honest, I have a more important task for you to complete.
Oh? Weston wonders as he reaches for another bottle.
Our sales may be through the roof, but I have a suspicion it's because we're the fashion world's equivalent of a train wreck. The world wants to watch us crumble. We're nothing more than a joke at this point, at least in their eyes. I'm afraid I don't follow.
Pain is beauty, Weston,
Upman answers in a low voice.
We cannot showcase our strength without acknowledging what we've overcome. The wounds we've suffered. The blood we've shed.
The macabre mobile lifts a sanguine bottle of Campari to a sunbeam crossing his way, casting the office in a muted, ruddy glow. He remains still, as if in a trance.
A diamond in the rough must be cleaved and cut and polished to be presentable. We've lost 7 jewels from our crown and never once considered to set them back into place.
Weston remains silent, allowing the pensive company president to complete his thoughts. Upman places down the bottle of booze and turns to look his photographer in the eyes.
I'm bringing them back to life. The children of destiny will be more than a mere fashion line. It is necromancy, a resurrection that will encompass all that we've lost and all that we've become. We are survivors. And on September 12th, we'll walk out on stage at Fashion Week with the faces of the dead watching us march onward.
At a loss for words, Weston simply implores with his eyes for further explanation.
Photographs, Weston. I need you to find and redevelop each and every photograph of the victims for the upcoming magazine. Select whichever shots you think are best for the runway event as well. I want them as larger-than-life tapestries watching over us.
I think you need to realize that I wasn't the only one who took those pictures, Mr. Upman. Don't forget about Duffy.
Oh, please.
Upman grumbles as he waves away Weston's concern.
All of the photos you take for the magazine belong to the magazine. There are no rights issues with using Duffy's photographs.
No, let's just say that Duffy isn't exactly organized. I have all of my negatives filed away and categorized by date in my office, but I'm not confident Duffy properly archived, well, anything.
Then you've got quite the task ahead of you, Weston. Don't worry about this.
He gestures with a nod to the liquor cabinet.
You focus on finding and developing those photographs for me. I don't care how long it takes, as long as all the preparations are made in time for Fashion Week.
The chic president adjusts his ascot in the reflection of the glass of his new piece of furniture before throwing on a light sport coat.
Speaking of, I have a meeting to attend.
The smiley face sticker placed on Theodore's studio wall crackles, and the sound of Upman's voice wanes until it is snuffed out altogether with the clang of his office door.
You heard the man.
Jazmine shrugs, sliding down from the countertop she'd been sitting upon as she addresses the crowd in the room, all listening in on the conversation high above them.
Upman's gonna be out of our hair for a while, so let's strike while this iron is hot.
Theodore spits out the drafting pin he was holding in his mouth, making marks on a piece of fabric he is trying to fit to a dress form.
By God, strike what?
A seamster gripes out loud.
This whole damn thing's a jumbled up jigsaw with missing pieces all over. I haven't the foggiest where to pick back up from.
Mina casts a cautious glance to their fearless leader, echoing the designer's exasperation with her own exhaustion.
Theo's got a point. I'm not even sure where to begin anymore. I feel like we've run through everything 100 times and gotten nowhere.
I have to admit,
Eloise says from her seat in the window without looking back into the room.
Letting La Cantina handle this business is getting more and more appealing.
Taken aback, Jazmine looks around the room as everyone but Alexa averts her gaze. The wind is almost instantly taken out of her sails as her shoulders sink.
What are you trying to say?
From the sticker on the table, Weston's voice pipes up.
No offense to you and Alexa, but they're certainly more qualified to deal with this situation than a short-staffed fashion magazine.
And for heaven's sake, Theodore sighs. We've just barely managed to scrape by to this point. Perhaps it's time we leave justice to the professionals.
Alexa grits her teeth and stomps across the room toward her purse where she grabs the worn newspaper she had taken from optics. She slams it onto the table in the middle of the room, her fingers sprawled across its front page to point at the date.
Finding the Square Biz killer isn't merely about justice,
she states severely, watching as everyone in the room moves in to look at the paper.
This was found at the Livewire Motel the day we rescued Jazmine. This was brought back in time by Optics himself. We could leave things to La Cantina, but what makes you think they're interested in protecting one of our own?
Jazmine Olivia JoJo Joplin collapsed on the runway in the middle of MAISON's showing of their Children of Destiny fashion line under mysterious circumstances in what can only be described as a supernatural phenomenon.
Mina reads aloud.
How is this possible?
Eloise questions, her brow furrowed.
That was not an ability he ever displayed.
Is how really as important as the possibility right now?
Alexa asks, a hand on her hip as she looks down on her comrades.
At the end of the day, this killer didn't target La Cantina or the CIA or the KGB. The Square Biz killer didn't just come after anyone. They came after us. And who are we again?
Theodore chuckles fondly at Alexa's use of her rival's words against them, feeling a renewed resolve as he finds the motivation he had lost once again.
We are MAISON,
he repeats, and Eloise rolls her eyes. Mina smiles with new determination as she looks over the rest of the group for reassurance.
Right. Even if we've already averted this future, it's better to play it safe than sorry.
Her gaze lands on Sunny, who had not only remained oddly silent for once, but hadn't even moved to join them around the newspaper.
Sunny? Is everything okay? Huh? Who? Me?
The pink-haired model straightens her spine as if being called on in class, looking up from some magazines she had apparently been poring over.
What are you looking at, dear?
Theodore asks curiously, and she picks up 2 issues to bring over to them. Eloise shakes her head at her friend, almost repulsed by what she placed before them, though she doesn't let a single muscle on her face twitch to show it.
Why do you even have that disgusting thing, Charlie?
Look here!
Sunny answers, turning to a page in a fairly recent issue of MAISON where her form is intersected by clean lettering and borders. She traces the image with one hand while the other points to the tabloid depicting her death, drawing comparisons between the 2 images. Laid side by side on the center table for all the studio to see, they appear a perfect match.
When Duffy pulled that superhero girl from his comic book, she came out all chopped up, right? Then I bet this is the exact picture he pulled out of me that caused all that mess!
Lovely.
Eloise sneers.
Now why don't you throw that garbage away?
Are you kidding me?
Sunny exclaims, picking up the tabloid proudly.
To frame this!
Now that you point it out, is it possible that Poppy is alive for the same reason?
Mina wonders, biting her thumbnail.
If you want some insight into the pictures that Duffy took, I can try to help.
Weston communicates from within Duffy's cluttered space, his voice carried by a soulful strut sticker.
I mean, I'm already going to be going through his archives anyway.
Good idea.
Alexa agrees.
Please let us know if you can find anything.
Well, I'll do my best.
He promises. A hint of uncertainty in his voice. The scratching of his head is audible, as one can assume he's staring at quite the mess before him. Jazmine lets out a quiet sigh of relief as her friends rally back around, thanks to Alexa's encouragement, and she squeezes her lover's hand as thanks before rounding out her shoulders and joining her team once more.
So let's say that all the previous victims were actually Duffy's clones.
She supposes.
And that would mean the rest of the girls might still be alive, right? Just like Poppy.
But why would Poppy appear all of a sudden? And where has she been all this time?
Eloise questions, following Jasmine's line of thought.
Poppy described the last thing she remembered as pure white light.
Mina recalls carefully, and she turns to the blonde model to see if she could be having the same realization. Sure enough, she was.
Dior.
Jasmine declares.
Oh yeah, good point.
A muffled voice erupts through a crack in the door to Theo's office. The artist sighs and flicks his wrist, calling on his stand to emerge and open the door for his captive to speak. Mickey remains partially rendered into fabric and pinned to a dress form, concluding with a smile.
Dr. Weird Science got his hands on her right around the time all this went down, huh? Who knows what he did to her?
Dior's eyes and ears were everywhere.
Mina reminds them.
If she was watching everything, if she knew as much as she did...
Jasmine concludes.
Using Duffy's copies as a guide for who to get rid of would be child's play. The White Room could have been their personal prison. In that case, the Square Biz killer isn't a killer after all. She's a kidnapper.
Alexa shakes her head, still unsure of how to make it all fit together.
But why go through all this trouble to kidnap some models and fake their deaths? How does she stand to gain?
She was always a spiteful old crone. And either way, one missing piece doesn't destroy the whole puzzle, dear.
Theodore remarks undaunted.
Not when every other piece fits together. The image is crystal clear.
Alexa's eyes flit back to the newspaper, grinding her teeth. But before she can argue, Jasmine squeezes her hand tight and calls out.
Hey, Mickey! What do you think Weird Science is gonna do with Duffy?
Oh, that pervert's the key to everything, I figure. That's why the doc was so adamant on bringing him in alive. What a rotten golden goose.
The patchwork man grumbles.
He'll be kept safe, I'm sure of it.
Then there it is. It's also just as likely the me who gets killed in the future is another girls on film clone.
Jasmine says with fire in her eyes, turning to a partner to plead for her faith.
This is the future I want to bet on, Alexa.
The skeptical woman sighs and forces a smile as she squeezes the smaller model's hand in return.
Then it seems this murder investigation just turned into a search party.
Tina, Amelia, Billy, Annie, Dorothy, Karine.
Jasmine mutters as she is caught in deep thought. She nods to herself, a personal promise to recover each and every one of them, and stands confidently with Alexa by her side. Addressing her crew, Jasmine proclaims,
"If Weston can find Poppy, we can find the others. I hardly think Upman is going to be upset if we don't come back empty-handed. He wanted a resurrection after all. Well, let's give it to him."
Resting in a spot of shade cast by a weave of highway overpasses, a small memorial to Tina Marie lay neglected and apparently untouched for some time. Nothing is left but a shattered vase with flowers that have long since died and been subsumed by the earth. The grass is left scorched by the summer sun, crumbling at the gentle touch of Jasmine's hand. She turns to face her partner, captivated by the callous graffiti splayed on the underside of the turnpike.
"Forgotten so easily."
Alexa whispers to herself before realizing her lover was standing in earshot and speaks up.
"I never knew her. I was given the order to infiltrate Maison right before Poppy was killed.
So you weren't first on the scene."
Jasmine realizes, rising from inspecting the abandoned memorial.
"But I doubt the cops did a thorough job."
Private Eyes traces the scenery, hovering high above and scanning as Alexa admits.
"I arrived months later to find clues they might have neglected, but Private Eyes didn't find anything back then either."
However, just as Alexa was bemoaning a lack of discoveries, her observant stand alerts her to a glimmering piece of gold hidden in the brush. When she digs inside, she uncovers a single radiant earring with 6 points, a star-shaped piece of jewelry treasured by Tina Marie herself.
22 carats in gold,
she gasps, turning to an incredulous Jasmine, her mouth agape.
"There's no way."
Jasmine holds out her hand to receive this gift to examine.
"Designer earrings like this aren't exactly in vogue anymore. And Tina was the only one at Maison that wore gold, right?"
she asks, turning the piece over in her palm.
"You said it yourself. You covered this place from head to toe. Private Eyes would have found this the first time you investigated."
When Alexa had first arrived in San Francisco, this had indeed been her first stop. And despite her thorough investigation, the scene of the crime was barren of any evidence. Yet somehow, from that day until this very moment, that golden earring found its way back home. The conclusion was obvious.
You're right,
she admits with a chortle. As she watches the glimmering reward shine in Jasmine's hand, she smiles, looking upon her lover with a sense of pride and admiration.
No matter how impossible things seem, even a lump of coal might turn to gold in your hands, Sonishka.
Another alert from Private Eyes interrupts the Russian agent's adoration. The shadow of a man looms beside their own, completely motionless amid the passing cars and their busy silhouettes. Yet as she turns her head to face the source of this figure, she finds nothing but swaying trees and skittering traffic.
Alexa?
The woman shakes her head, admitting with a wry smile and a light chuckle,
It was nothing. Just the last of my paranoia surprising me.
Come, we should let the others know what we found. And we might not be the only ones with such luck.
The shadows stretch and creep as the sun begins its descent. In the hours of dusk, Sunny and Eloise scour the craggy shore underneath the Golden Gate Bridge, trying to find some evidence of Amelia Weinman's presence. The exact location of where her body was discovered remained a mystery even to this day, and so Sunny had been asking each and every possible lamppost, rock, and tree within the vicinity, to little avail.
I'm sorry,
one fern pine laments.
I was a lot smaller when that happened. I didn't really get to see much, and the guy growing in front of me got cut down recently.
Oh, I know how you feel,
Sunny empathizes.
Like going to a concert, but the person sitting in front of you blocks your view. So annoying!
Sherry,
Eloise groans, snapping the excitable woman back to attention.
We have been at this all day and have come up empty. I think it's time we call it quits, yes?
Sunny droops her shoulders, sulking as she removes the sticker from the animated pine tree and trudges over to her partner.
All right.
The usually chipper model relents, her enthusiasm utterly deflated by their lack of progress. However, before they can make another move toward the steps leading back up to higher ground, a seagull's caw arrests them. The bird interrupts, landing on a nearby brick wall serving as a bulwark against the waters. From its beak hangs a crystal necklace, which Eloise snatches from their avian ally.
Where did you find this?
It was all I could find!
The seagull screeches back, its harsh call blending with human speech translated and spoken by the bright yellow sticker placed on its back.
I didn't see the woman you're looking for, but this was what she was wearing in the photo you showed me, right over there on the rocks!
Retrieving the picture in question from her back pocket, Eloise is stunned as she compares the two handcrafted pieces of jewelry. The one in her hand matches the one in the photo with an undeniable likeness. They were, in fact, identical in every way.
She was here!
Sunny blurts out with a widening smile.
She was here, Ella!
In the midst of her bubblegum-haired friend's celebration, a shiver reaches up Eloise's spine as the shadows encroach. Something lingering within them calls her attention, yet she cannot pinpoint its exact location.
We should leave,
the morose model suggests tersely. Sunny's stomach grumbles in that instant, and the giddy woman agrees, brought back down from Cloud 9 by her own empty stomach.
Oh, yeah!
She concedes, walking up the steps with Eloise beside her.
What do you want to grab, Elo? Tacos? A big stinking burger?
Eloise, her eyes piercing the darkness coming in behind them, grimly opines.
Something makes me think calamari.
The night has finally set. A pair of bright pink sunglasses catch the light of passing lampposts as Theodore carries them down the street and back toward Maison Tower, glowing in the distance.
I can't believe it! Carrying sunglasses!
He remarks, stupefied. Mina sniffles, overcome with relief that they had just proven their unlikely theory. She blots her tears away with a handkerchief given to her by her fabulous friend, knowing that now is not the right time to be shedding them.
Oh! I'm going to have to come up with an awful excuse for Upman. He'll know I've been crying.
Yes, well, you know you're not the best liar,
Theo admits, sliding the sunglasses into his pocket. Placing his hands on Mina's shoulders, he pushes her along, aware of something following them in the darkness. However, he tries his best not to let his blissfully unaware friend catch on to his concern.
Let's get you back to him before he truly becomes irate, yes?
As they proceed down the street in haste, the inky black tendrils of shadow stalking them recede back into the abyss of the night. Despite the hours passing and twilight having descended upon the city, Poppy Argo remains restless, eagerly awaiting the return of her caretaker. Spending any time away from Weston was an excruciating experience, as his presence was her only means of comfort and stability. And so she waits by the bedroom window, looking out to the city with a cup of tea in her hands, tediously counting the seconds until his return. The sound of rustling from outside the apartment alerts her to someone's presence, and she happily leaps from the bedside to greet her savior. Yet as she approaches the hallway, the sound continues, emanating now from behind her. The entry door remains shut, its handle unmoving, and as she turns back to look into the bedroom, she glimpses a shadowy figure in the fire escape window as it is wrenched open. Steiner Optics makes his way into Weston Archer's apartment, looking around for some sign of life before breaching the remainder of the photographer's home.
Anyone there?
He taunts with a snicker, knowing full well his adversary was preoccupied that night. There, of course, is no response. Still unkempt and garbed in his striped prison uniform, Optic scratches his head, rustling the matted black mess that rests upon his shoulders.
Now, where to begin?
He muses in frustration as he slinks around to search the apartment. He passes by the fresh cup of tea and furrows his brow in curiosity, but his attention is torn away when he hears a small commotion in the next room over that he swears sounded like a stifled whimper. Exiting the master bedroom, he follows the noise to see a door labeled Dark Room. Do not open, left ajar, leaving the hall awash in an incandescent crimson glow. From beneath a table covered in black cloth, Poppy watches the home invader cautiously enter Weston's darkroom, with both hands covering her mouth. Tears well up in the corners of her eyes as she tries desperately to remain silent and not further alert the trespasser. The floorboards creak louder under the stalker's feet as he approaches, growing closer until Poppy could feel his presence. The prowler's shadow creeping ever closer toward her hiding place.
Sorry to have kept you so long. Upman apologizes to Mina as he stows away documents in a filing cabinet near his desk.
You're just the only one who can make sense of these numbers.
The young secretary smiles with a nod.
Yes, there's just this one charge that I can't account for, Mr. Upman.
She scratches her head, obsessing over the invoice in her hand.
$500 is a lot of money to lose track of.
Oh, that's right. You've just reminded me.
The president says with an uncharacteristic grin as he glances at his watch. He retrieves something from one of the drawers in his desk and takes several steps to hand a white envelope to the unsuspecting Mina.
It's still only 11:28, so there's still time to say, well, happy birthday.
You shouldn't have, Mr. Upman.
Mina's face goes pale as she opens the envelope to reveal the $500 in question.
Mr. Upman, I can't take this kind of money.
Tuition, he explains. You're majoring in linguistics with a minor in business, right? Well, consider that an investment. In your business education, mind you, not your language classes.
The meek secretary tries to take a step back, but her skewed sense of balance keeps her from completing it. Before she tumbles to the ground, Upman reaches for her hand and holds her upright. With genuine concern, he asks,
Good Lord, Mina, are you all right?
The young girl releases her grip and is at last able to take those steps backward, bowing in appreciation to her elder.
I'm fine.
She lies.
Just a bit overwhelmed, is all.
Well, don't take it for granted. I want you to study hard, you hear me? Now go, I've kept you far too long. And be careful. The halls are dark at this hour. Don't want you stumbling around and hurting yourself,
lawsuit waiting to happen. Mina beams a thankful smile and, with misty eyes, happily acquiesces to her boss's orders.
Yes, sir.
The young secretary slips out of the lavish doors and into the darkness that is Maison at night. Very little light finds its way through the building at this hour, and Mina is guided by what few lamps light her way about the penthouse floor. The clapping of her miniature wedge heels slowly fades from the hallway, only for the deeper, darker sound of heavy boots to take their place, resounding from an unlit corner and growing closer with every step. Some alien figure cloaked in darkness approaches the unattended threshold.
Thank you.